We are at the international headquarters of the Chirp with Daren Millard in Las Vegas, Nevada. A little windy here today. I'm going to have to admit, like the dome that does the weather, controls all the weather here, must have had a hold in it today because a little breezy. Looking forward to today's episode. We'll get to Sam Bennett in just a little bit. Ray Ferraro joins us right out of the gate. TSN, Ray and Dreg's podcast with Daren Dreger. He's married to Hockey Hall of Famer Cammy Granato. We get into most of that as Cammy prepares for the Seattle Kraken launch. But as we bounce around the league, we start with the most basic of issues being, what the heck year is it? Honest answer from this question. I need you to promise me you'll give me a 100% honesty.
Before I know the question.
Before you know the question.
96% I can give you.
Do you?
I got to have some leeway, right?
When you talk about last year or the year before that or 2 years ago, do you actually know what years you're talking about when I'm on the,
because I don't
on the
no.
air.
Yeah. 100% no. I have said, you know, last year or whenever it was, I have no idea. Right. Because last year, like last March, I was in Toronto when everything got shut down last March. So to me, that was last year. But then we got the problem of the bubble. And I don't really know if that was part of last year, even though I do know it was exactly last year. And then the season didn't start in the right time. So I'm not sure what to say about the part of the year where we didn't have hockey.
Right.
So I have 2 years ago seems, in a way, it's like 3 years ago.
Exactly.
You cannot say he's coming off a good year because I don't know when that was.
So I was thinking about, because I catch myself all the time going last year and what was last year. And or somebody says, how long have you been in Vegas now? I say like, well, it's a year. No, it's almost 2 years. It's like two seasons. And then I was thinking about the last time I actually saw you, and it was in Winnipeg in a press box. And I'm like, was that 3 years ago or four?
That was in the playoffs.
That was in the playoffs when the year the Blues won. Well, that was only 2 years ago.
Okay. So the Blues won in 19.
Yes. So
that is 2 years.
2 years ago. But I was,
I've started to lose the years the teams have won only because of the bubble last year. Mm-hmm. And now I've got to like reverse engineer it and go, oh yeah, Tampa, St. Louis. Like I got to work backwards. Yeah. Like
there was a time when you knew that off by heart, right? Like
when did Washington win?
Yeah. Yeah. That was
10 years ago.
Yeah.
It was 3 years ago, but it seems so long ago.
Mm-hmm. That brings up a good memory of mine when Kippy brought up the Dallas New Jersey rematch, and you said it's not a rematch if it was 8 years ago.
Yes, there's not a rematch that does not count.
If it was last year, it was a rematch. You're looking at him. Well, that's not a rematch. It was eight years ago.
So that brings up something here in my head. You know what stat I don't like? Vegas is 2-7 on Tuesdays.
Oh yeah.
Like why could that possibly matter?
When we intro, it's a Tuesday. This the 3-0 on a Tuesday.
Oh, look out. Yeah. Tuesdays are bad news for these guys. The kids don't get off to school on time on Tuesdays. Yeah. It's a tough day.
And the analysts are okay. They're sitting there because they're like, oh, well, we never would have used that anyway. So the host isn't pretending he's an analyst. So we're
okay. Let's be honest. When there's good nuggets that come out, your hope when one gets through the host, I'm really happy. I'm like, that's a good one. I can shovel that one into the broadcast somewhere. I like it.
That's good. That's good. Hey, the awards are going to be announced. This is the stretch drive. So who's got a better hold on something? Is it Kirill the Thrill? Oh, with the Calder, or is it Connor McDavid with the Hart Trophy? Who do you think has the better grip?
Oh, I think McDavid.
Yeah.
I can't build a case for anybody to be more important than McDavid is. I just saw a stat with him on the ice. They're plus like 88. And without him, they're like minus 100 and something. And I'm like, how is that even possible? Goals for and against. Like, how could a guy be How could it be that?
That's unhockey-like. That's basketball, like starters versus bench.
That's exactly what it is. And that's why hockey never has the dominant personality player like basketball can have, because a guy plays 46 of 48 minutes. And in hockey, of course, it doesn't happen. When I watch McDavid play now, though, I'm telling you, Daren, it's like, it's not an if, it's a when. Yeah. When I'm watching them play, I guess it's last week or so against Montreal, they're down 1-0 after two periods. Just the way the game was going, it's like, I wonder when he's going to score. I wonder when it is. And he got a goal and two assists in the third period. There was an inevitability to it. And I would say the thing about the awards that, since I started voting on them and stuff, what I really dislike is if you make your choice and you vote for someone, whoever it is, it doesn't mean you hate the other guy. It doesn't mean you think the other guy is no good. If I'm voting for the Calder right now, I'm going to vote for Kirill Kaprizov. I think he's made an impact on that team that is incredible. I also think Jason Dickinson is a hell of a player. And I didn't think he was going to be this effective. But I can only pick one. And just because I pick one doesn't mean I don't respect and or like the other player. And I think that gets lost in the air somewhere.
That sounds like you're talking to Twitter. And Robertson's been awesome. Like he has been like just lights out and kind of come out of nowhere in the grand scheme of like Dallas's season. But it sounds like you're talking to Twitter.
A little, for sure. Yeah. There seems to be this now, is Kaprizov too old because he played in the KHL? Look, we already have a rule. They put it in when Makarov was 30 years old and they put in 25. Now, because this outlier case is here, I'm seeing like this dust kicked up about maybe it should be 22. Well, what does that mean for a four-year college player?
Yeah.
Does that mean he's not a pro? He's been playing college, but now he's too old. He can't win the rookie of the year.
And he plays a year in the minors. And then boom.
So does the minors take people out of the equation? In a lot of cases, I find we create a problem or an issue where it's not there. If you I saw somebody say it should be 250 pro games. So somebody's played 251 and somebody's played 248. So the 248 counts and the 251 doesn't. Like it doesn't make any sense. They put it, if you want to move the age a bit or two, fine. You've got to account for the college players. You've got to account for somebody playing a year in the American League. But to me, it's much mess about nothing.
We'll spend more time studying the rules than we will actually evaluating who's going to win the award. That's what's going to happen there.
Yeah, kind of like the offside rule.
Do you like it or no?
I like it now.
Yeah.
Because I thought it was killing an ant with a sledgehammer before.
Yeah.
Matt Duchene's 50 feet offside. They put this rule in. When I was ever trying to explain hockey, I'm sure you did it forever, to somebody that was just catching on. One of the easiest rules to explain was offside. Puck has to go over the blue line first. That was it. I mean, that's how it was our whole, and then Duchene got, was in the next county.
Yes.
And they scored and they missed it somehow. And so now there's this boondoggle of a rule. When it first came in, one of my first games, there was a review. And so the producer says in my ear, they're going to review the goal. I'm like, for what? The play entered the zone like 30 seconds before. I wasn't even aware that was going to be in the mix. So when there's a review now, I'm like, oh man, I hope there's no review. I just hope there's not.
Yeah.
Because now you're down there and you're on splitting hairs on hands and knees to, it's like, it's complicated things to a point where I think I like review for goals, but it's complicated things to a point where I don't know if we're getting ahead of the thing or behind it.
You know how golf does the playthrough and they do the squeeze back? You can still watch the golf at the commercials. That's what we should do for reviews. So we don't have to analyze and try to predict and then we're wrong.
Right.
We could just put the ad up here, little box down here of the refs.
Well, and you as an ex-goalie, of course, I'm sure you review everything, including people breathing in the zone as goalie interference. Where I think it's, we're incredibly protective. I think the key to goalie interference is if there's a guy stationed in the blue paint, the play gets blown dead.
Yeah.
That takes away 90% of the, me and you get, we're doing a yeah. game together and you're like, what do you think? And you're like, oh, I don't know. I guess he hit the butt end of his stick. And I'm like, yeah, but he got kind of shoved. And at the end of it, we're like, eh.
The only thing I'll say is I wish they would call a penalty on goalie interference more instead of the incidental contact. That's what I don't get.
Okay. So if you have what was the international rule, now they're morphing more towards the NHL standard, which I don't particularly like, but a player can skate through the blue paint, but as soon as they set up shop, they blow the whistle. So that takes away the penalty. It takes yep. away the potential for some mess to happen. I don't know why that rule is so hard to get around. Like why they can't just say, you know what? I like that rule. The NHL really seems to have a hard time following the international standard as opposed to the other way around. And nobody's got all the right answers.
No. It's the tag up rule has been confusing a little bit. I watch the players even now, they get to the, and all you have to do is touch the blue line, but guys tag up by going 4 feet into the neutral zone and coming back. Like you're wasting, like the whole idea is to get back and get back in.
But I bet you the players don't know the rule.
Hmm. Oh, maybe.
And the reason I say that is they changed the rule to tag up went in at one point and I was playing. And I remember we were all yelling at the linesman, that's offside. And he turned around and said, they changed the rule in the summer. And we're like, oh, like we weren't up to speed. So I think the guys know the rules, but in a lot of cases, they're not really sure.
Right. So if they get into the neutral zone,
they're safe.
Yeah, I'm good.
I'm safe there. Yeah.
What's wrong with Toronto's power play? You've played on yep. talented teams. You've played on teams that had to really grind it out. So give me an idea of what's going on there.
I think we all look for one reason. I rarely think in sports it's one reason. I think there's several things that play into almost any situation. The power play for me starts clearly with your entry into the zone. They used to have a more up-tempo entry, a quicker entry. They got the puck into the hands of Marner and Matthews quicker, and they let them attack the blue line. Mm-hmm. Now it seems to meander their way up the ice. They've changed personnel a couple of times. They've lost their flow into the zone. So it takes too long to get in. Then when they get in, they're disjointed. So the puck goes down the zone or down the ice. They got to go back and get it. So entry is number one. Two is once they get set up, their attack at the net lacks a scary point shot. It lacks the creative mobility at the top. And then when it gets into Marner and Matthews' hands, it's really predictable. Early in the year, my view of that Leaf power play is it was murder because you couldn't predict it. As soon as those penalty killers get their hands on video and they start to isolate players, the best option goes. Now you've got to create something else. They've not done it. And the puck goes back to Morgan Rielly. He doesn't have a big one-timer. He doesn't create along the blue line. So that takes that option away. The penalty killers don't fear it. They know when it goes to Marner, even though he shoots the puck more, he doesn't shoot it a lot. They know he wants to go across the seam to Matthews. If you can deny that pass, well, now you've really complicated things. So all those things add up to a power play that's searching and to me is not creative enough as it should be.
So how do you fix it mid-season? I thought like a net front presence would really help them. And I know he's been in and out of the lineup, but yeah. I thought that would make a difference. And
okay. So now they've got Nylander down at the bottom. Mm-hmm. I like it because you've got the skill of Nylander. He seems more willing not to set up shop like Wayne Simmonds could. I mean, there was a time Simmonds was as good at it as anybody, but that puck has to be able to go down and make a play out of the hole, out of the goal line. It can't happen quick enough. I don't think often enough with Simmonds or even Joe Thornton for that matter. Joe's not, he's 41, man.
Yeah.
He's not what he used to be. If the puck goes down to Nylander, though, he's got to know that he has to attack the net. Again, you've got to threaten an option or the penalty killers are going to ignore you. If the puck goes from Matthews to Nylander, it's got to come to Tavares. Like, it's got to come there. Sometimes it has to be there. You can't have Tavares standing in the, you know, in the bumper spot and he's a museum piece. Like, he's, you got to use him. Look at the, for me, the best power play for the last 10 years, two of them have been Boston and Washington. Look at their bumper guys. It's DJ Oshie and Patrice Bergeron. They're among their most smart, intelligent players, and they can shoot the one-timer. They don't just put the guy there to stand there. To me, those are the best power plays, and those are two of the biggest reasons for it.
I watch power plays, and I go, why can't somebody do that? And then you realize who that is in that bumper spot.
Yeah.
It's
you know,
so
where I first noticed Bergeron, you know, like to another level from in my mind was when my son Landon was playing in Boston. So I watched him 55 times. Mm-hmm. I couldn't believe how good he is. Like how strong he, like you seen Patrice Bergeron walk in his suit. He's not a big guy, yet he's strong on the puck. And then you go, wow, he look how he uses his body. He gets in position. Then I started watching him on the power play and the bumper. The puck comes in, it always goes to the right guy, the next guy at the right time. He doesn't get it and just bump it right back to the guy. You know, you give it to me, I give it to you. Well, that doesn't do anything. The penalty killers don't move anywhere. He gets it, it goes down low. And of course, they're blessed with Marchand and, you know, McAvoy now. And, you know, it used to be Krug and they've got Greslick and Pasternak's a brilliant player. Like, I know they've got pieces around, but the key point is when the puck comes into those guys, to Oshie and to Bergeron, it goes to the right guy next.
Do players start to dread the power play, the good players, when they get an opportunity?
I made most of my living on the power play. Yeah. You know, scored well over 100 goals on it. And when you're bad, you don't rush out there. you have no swagger.
But even you're having a good season, 5-on-5, but you get a power play and you're like,
yes,
really?
And you're like, guys, like, let's get it going here. We've practiced, you know, like you practice it. It works great in practice because nobody's really blocking shots.
Yeah. And if the penalty killers have their sticks upside down.
Upside down. And if they deflect too many passes, you get really sour at them. Yeah. Then they start doing it just to bug you. Right? Like they're doing it on purpose.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh man, these guys like, oh, drive you crazy. So you can practice it. You feel okay, but you know, it's not real. Then you get into the game and the tempo's so high. It seems once you start bobbling it, you never settle it down. You move the puck around the outside, you go back to the bench and you're like, we didn't even have a shot. And then they take another penalty and you got to go back out there again. And you have no clue where the attack point is because, well, nothing happened the last one.
Right.
There are good power plays that go to dust and they never get it back.
Wow. Colorado and Vegas appears to be like one of those series that everybody wants to see. Do the players want to see it as well? And how do they not look ahead?
The way you don't look ahead is your team has probably been kicked in the shin somewhere before. Mm. And you realize the immediacy of the series first means, yeah, we want to play Colorado because they're the best team, or we want to play Vegas because they're the best team, but we can only get there if we get through the immediate hurdle.
Yeah.
And chances are you stay in the moment because you didn't get past the immediate hurdle the first time. I think the best example is Tampa 2 years ago. 2 years ago, was it?
You're like a good comedian. You bring it all the way back to the start.
All of a sudden, I'm like, oh, I don't know if it was 2 years. Because, right, everybody was talking about Tampa. They got 60 wins and what a team. And, oh, they didn't get by Columbus. The immediate hurdle was the biggest hurdle. I would love to watch Vegas and Colorado play because, in my mind, they play the style that I like the best. It's physical. It's fast. It's attack. Like, when do either of those teams not attack? And they play defense by having the puck. They play defense by pressure. They play defense by speed and skill. Now, I'm gonna quote and a biased quote here of my brother-in-law, Don Granato, who I think is doing a fabulous job with a a roster in Buffalo that, I mean, there's no Eichel, there's no Oposo. They traded Taylor Hall. They've got no goalies.
They've got 10 players.
It's astounding what they're doing to be in each game. And they asked him about a system versus skill. And he said, yeah, we have a system, but you know how we're going to play that system better? By improving our skill. Mm-hmm. And to me, when I look at Colorado and Vegas, that's what they have. They have skill that allows them to play a system. Otherwise, you're just playing punt coverage. You just shoot it down the ice, you trap, you hold, you try and pace the game off until you get a chance. Vegas and Colorado don't do that. And that's why I like watching those guys.
If you're one of those two teams, do you hope the other one gets knocked off?
Yes.
Okay. It's not one of those ones where we really want to play the best team. I don't want to play the best team. I want to play the team that I have the better chance of winning against.
That's who you want to play. In 93, I'm with the Islanders. We're in the conference finals. We're playing Pittsburgh. I've heard this story various ways, 100 different times, that when David Volek scored in overtime in game 7, mm-hmm. the Canadian players were in their hotel and they were screaming and yelling, jumping up and down in the hallways because Pittsburgh was out and they got to play us.
Really?
They were thrilled. We don't have to play that. The Penguins had a Hall of Fame team and we were us. Like, who are they going to be afraid of? Me? Glenn Healy? Pat Flatley? No, they were like Mario, Jagr, Lemieux. You know, Kevin Stevens was hurt, of course, but Larry Murphy, Tom Barrasso, like they were way more worried about those guys than us.
You're right. Like even a team of destiny, like that, we'll take our chances spelling destiny. And
yeah, well, because they felt they were destiny. They won, right. I think, 10 overtime 10 games. Overtime. And so they're like, we get to play the Islanders. We'll outscore them. We'll be fine against them. And they were.
You mentioned you do vote on some awards. How are you going to do it? I don't know whether you have a strategy in place because you're following all the 4 different independent leagues. I'm just curious on your strategy.
My view on how I'm going to do it is, you know, I started to keep closer eye, I'd say a couple of weeks ago, on different players that might, like, for example, the Selke Trophy. That's a hard trophy to vote on.
You got to watch in person, don't you? Like to really. Yeah.
And how do you separate division from division? Like, I don't know. I think Brad Marchand should be in the Selke Trophy voting. Mm-hmm. Kills penalties, one of the best penalty killers in the league. No, he's not a shutdown guy. That's, some people will say, yeah, but he scores too much to be. Well, wait a minute. How does that? I mean, you know, like the lines have all been blurred. Like Barkov, he's an MVP candidate for me. But he plays the same 5 teams all the time.
Right.
How do you know? And so how I'm going to do it, aside from the long way to get to your answer, is I'm going to talk more frequently to people from the divisions. Like, who do you like in your division in these awards? Then I can start going back. I'll probably use analytics more this year than I would normally in the past.
And you're an analytics guy?
Quasi.
Okay.
I think the analytics will help me narrow down what I think I see.
Okay.
I'll give you an example. I just saw one today. I've watched Ryan Nugent Hopkins since he's 13 years old. Mm-hmm. A fabulous kid, really good player. I have a tough time trying to figure out, can he drive play? Like on his own line, if he's not with McDavid or Draisaitl, could you play those two guys together and be confident enough that Nugent Hopkins would be a guy that could anchor another line? Mm-hmm. Per 60 minutes, he's got 0.1 primary assists this year. 0.1. Wow. Huh. To me, that tells me he's a pretty secondary player. Yeah. He's a support player. And so I normally think that analytic helps me confirm that.
Reinforces your eye test.
Yes. I think they have to work together. I don't know how people can say, I don't view analytics as of any value. I don't understand how you could say that. And I don't understand how people can say they're the whole picture, because there's not. There's no analytic yet to tell me how courageous a player is, how smart a player is. Like, how would you measure that? You've got to watch. Like, is there an analytic that tells me Patrice Bergeron is as smart as he is? I don't think so.
No, other than he's really good. And there's been smart players that are, or players that have been really good that you would go, drill buster.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. But I mean, I'm saying as a sole analytic,
yeah,
is there something that can tell me
no
how clever he is, or do I need to watch it? I think I need to watch it. And I like that I'm able to view some other parts of the equation in some more detailed stats, as opposed to what we used to have, plus minus, a face-off percentage, things like that. There are times I think stats are, they're intrusive. You know, like a good face-off guy. So say you're 59% mm-hmm. and I'm 53%. Over 100 face-offs, that's almost nothing.
Right. And it's, and who are you playing with? Wingers that bust their ass, or?
Yeah. Or I used to take a draw once in a while against Wayne Gretzky. I beat him every time in the neutral zone. They didn't try. I don't want to ruin his tape, but you get down in either zone and you couldn't beat him.
Yeah.
Right. So like, there's so much more to just I want to look at a stat, a number, and have it tell me the story. And so, but I think it's going to be valuable for me this year as I try to put together a mess of voting. Like, there will be people not happy with the voting results this year, even more so than generally speaking.
Oh, I think it's really hard. Difficult. It's going to be really hard. Like, that's because you're working four nights a week in the rink. When do you have time to sit there and watch three other divisions and all the games?
Like, well, the answer is you don't. You just can't. Don't. Yeah, you can't. And you can try and catch snippets here and there, but how much does that help? Like, what if you watch? I don't know what. What if you watch Jason Robertson and Kirill Kaprizov and you watch them two or three times mm-hmm. and the two times you happen to watch Jason Robertson, he has a terrible night.
Right.
He just doesn't have it that night. And you watch Kaprizov two times and he scores two goals like he scored this weekend. Well, to you, it's no contest. And then you look at the stats and you go, wait a minute, they've scored the same number of even strength goals. They're only a few points apart. You're like, how the hell did that happen?
Yeah.
I think it's going to be really hard.
Norris is one of those ones where Hedman is so good that, and there's not really that dominant play. Like all the other players that have points, you go, good players, but not great defenders. So maybe the Norris is easier, but like Selke, Vezina, Vasilevsky's great, but you play the same teams all the time.
Right. Like that's, there will be no easy way this year. Like, okay, for example, one of the other awards that we don't vote on, but is going to be Coach of the Year.
See, that one's, I think finally we might have a Coach of the Year of a great team. Does that make sense? Like not the most improved
as opposed
team.
To as somebody that kind of takes a team off the scrap heap.
Yeah.
But I'm looking at the guys that have to be candidates, right? Rod Brindamore has to be one.
Mm-hmm.
Joel Quenneville has to be one.
Yeah.
I mean, like, who did anybody have Florida up in this sort of thing?
No, I had them closer to that last year and then they disappointed me and now they're there. Yeah.
Would Pete DeBoer and Jared Bednar be in there?
Yeah.
Have to be. Yeah. What about Sheldon Keefe?
Mm-hmm.
What about John Cooper?
Cooper, like, what he's done without two Hall of Famers for most of the year is extraordinary.
Pretty good stuff.
Yeah.
So I think that's, do you have one that jumps out at you as a favorite?
Cooper and DeBoer are mine. But then DeBoer, I'll be accused of being biased.
Well, of course.
But what he's done since he's taken over has been extraordinary with a good team.
Which is not as easy as people think.
Right.
You know, and then I look at, you know, the complications that teams have had to face in this year. Mm-hmm. You know, Colorado is, you know, Grubauer test positive for COVID. And so you don't have a goalie having almost a Vezina trophy season.
Yep.
And so they've had to do that. Mikko Rantanen's not there all the time. Vegas has had to dance around several issues.
Yeah.
There's some good coaches. There's some good coaches on teams having really good years.
I'm going to wrap it up this way. You and Cammy are co-coaches. Okay.
Yep.
How do you guys divide up the responsibilities?
First thing we do is we hire somebody to look after the defense because neither of us are going to be back there. We are looking for a defense coach, chop, chop.
Who runs the power play?
Oh, she would run the power play.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah. We probably are the only couple that has napkins at dinner with power really? Play stuff on them.
I love that.
We debate over players, and then next thing I know, there's a piece of paper out. One of us has grabbed it. We're doing something where she likes a player, I don't like a player, or vice versa. Now we're arguing over the merits of this player playing versus that player. She was a power play specialist. So she'll run the power play.
You were two.
Yeah, but I was always the second banana on the power play. Like, you know, like in Hartford, or second or third, we had Ron Francis and Kevin Dineen, mm-hmm. right? Power play always went through there. With the Islanders, it always went through Pierre Turgeon. By the time I got out there, the penalty killers were tired. Pete had worn them down, and then I could do a little bit of stuff. I was on the number one power play in Atlanta, which probably tells you a lot of the story. That's why they're in Winnipeg. So...
Would you get mad when the number one power play unit would stay out too long?
Always.
Yeah.
You know what was the worst? I'll tell you, this is the all-time worst of being on the second power play. So I go to the Rangers, sign as a free agent. Number one power play is Mark Messier, yeah. Adam Graves, Pat Verbeek, Brian Leetch, and I forget who the other defense. I never worried about the defense, but it was Brian Leetch.
Yeah.
So the second power play was me, Alex Kovalev, and Luke Robitaille. Pretty good group.
Pretty good group. Power play.
So Colin Campbell was the coach. He'd say, razor your lines up, you know, to take the power play. And it would be a race to not take Mark.
Really?
Because he was staying out there.
Yeah.
And so every once in a while, we'd have to go first. And so we'd be fiddling around in the zone. Puck would get shot down. Puck would go down to our zone. And I'd look over at the bench. Well, we all would. And Mark would have one leg over the boards.
You've just lost a draw. And 10 seconds in.
I'm expected to change here pretty quickly. that was a guarantee. So if you were the second power play behind Metz, no chance. Then we go to LA. If you had Luke, you might as well sat down. Puck would go down. We'd get in the zone, get shot down. Puck would go back in the zone. We'd change. Luke would always go to the far side from the benches.
Smart.
And so he'd come back and go, oh, sorry, guys. I didn't know we were changing. Yeah, you've been out there a minute 40. What do you think? Oh, he was the best.
And that hasn't changed, right? Like from era to era, that's always been the case.
Big dog stays for as long as he needs to stay.
Yeah.
You know, like the teams that have two equal power plays, it's like a quarterback controversy. That means they don't have one quarterback.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to be on the power play. If Nate McKinnon wants to stay a minute 45 on the power play, that's how long he's staying.
Right? I'm impressed that it doesn't cause more trouble in the room when guys can't.
Well, okay. So I'm the second power play. Yeah. I go up to Connor McDavid and say, hey, Connor, could you shorten up your shift a little bit so I can get out there?
Yeah.
There's a pecking order never established. Like there's no list. Yeah. You know where you fit.
But what about if you're like 28th in the league and that guy's pulling that?
Oh, then you're saying something.
Yeah.
You might say, hey, wait a minute. You've been out there a minute 30 and it doesn't matter.
And we're over our last 13.
Let's change the record here. Let's change it up a bit.
You're awesome. I love chatting with you. And we'll have to do it again when we can get into some other goofy stories from the past. Yep. But I love leaning on because the Canadian division has been such a focus that I was curious to get your opinion on. And we get locked into the West and everything. So this is great. And Cammy's doing well. Looking forward to this expansion draft. That's going to be fascinating to watch.
Me too. I got to tell you, I told you the story offline and it's 100% the fact is, people ask me, what do you know? Who are they like? Who are they taking? I go into her office, computer closes. I have zero idea what the hell the Kraken are doing. I grind her. I'm looking for numbers. I'm looking for, hey, who do you like? Oh, what about this guy? Nothing.
Pulling quotes from here and here and trying to put them together.
Put a bit, nothing. I get nothing. So I know she's excited about it. They're, you know, they're grinding away. The expansion draft's going to come fast. You know, there's there. I saw the Kraken had tweeted the other day. They're inside 100 days.
Wow.
And it's, and of course there's pressure to field a good team, but there's also pressure because Vegas has come out of the chute and just smashed the ball out of the park. I always felt, and I don't know, you know, you're there every day now and you see it, but I thought Kelly McCrimmon and George McPhee, they gamed the system. They knew the rules. They were aware of what was going to happen more than the other general managers. Like I thought they did an amazing job of finding pressure points and being able to acquire assets. And it's going to be harder to find those pressure points for Ron Francis, but the pressure point is going to be the 81.5 cap. They're going to end up with extra picks and players. Teams are saying, oh, we're just going to tell them take one player. Yeah, but you're still at the cap. Mm-hmm. So they're going to have, they're going to offload a contract they likely don't want, and they're going to have to pay to do it. And that's going to be Seattle's pressure point.
Like if Ron is merciless, he can game the system too.
Yeah. I think, but, and don't you think you have to be?
You have to be, but there's relationships though. Like he's been a manager for a long time. He's got relationships with these guys. And you don't think that.
So just think you can go, I could say, you know, like you could go to your buddy, your GM, your relationship guy and say, hey, I see you're jammed up against the cap. I'll take that contract from it. It's cost you a first, but I'm going to help you out.
Yeah.
See, you're still being a friend.
Sort of.
Sort of, kind of.
Is that what you do in the golf course? Like you can have that one, but.
You've already lost the hole, but you can have
absolutely. That. You got the golf gear on. You're playing it all? How's the
I'm going to the range when we get out of here.
Good.
We've being at home means no travel, which means I'm playing more golf in April than I ever have. I go to two places. Seriously. I go to the golf course and the grocery store. That's it. Like where else are we going? I don't, you know, that's what we got right now.
You're spending more time at one on the, I know that, of those two.
Yes, because you can't order the golf course to your front door.
You're the best. Thanks for doing this, pal.
It's awesome to see you, Daren. I'm glad everything's working well in Vegas. You're where you should be. And it's seriously, you're right back where you should be. It's great to listen to you guys. You do an amazing job in Vegas. And hopefully we get into a rink where we can
hang out.
Sit down and have one a bit.
Yeah, that the last time we saw each other was you, me, Panger, and I can't remember who else sitting at a table. Oh, Louis DeBrusque was there. And it was
just think of that. The two last people you put there, one of the biggest humans on the planet and one of the smallest. If you're eating nachos by Louis, you got no chance.
You got shrapnel. Shrapnel all over you.
You will get it. Louis's a big boy. He's a big boy, and Panger is one of the best. So we'll get that table back. I'd love it.
I did a lot of listening on that table. Thanks, pal.
Take care. Be well.
Get to the Pang stuff. I'll dive into that relationship in just a little bit. Handsy today. I do a lot of pointing on the podcast, but should also illustrate behind me, the Brandon Wheat King sweater. People in Brandon will be upset if I don't acknowledge that Ray Ferraro in 1984-85 Western Hockey League record 108 goals in one season, 108 goals in a single season. That still stands in the Western Hockey League. Ray also had a very feisty side to him when he played 1,288 penalty minutes in the National Hockey League. 1,200 penalty minutes. That's amazing. So it takes me to a little nugget that I discovered. And this is for podcast people only. They're listening to this. Nobody else has brought this up. So you only get this at the Chirp with Darren Millard. Ty Domi led the National Hockey League in penalty minutes 1 year. Hard to believe that it was only 1 year. Max Domi, as of recording, leads the National Hockey League this season in penalty minutes. if he follows through on that, and it's very close with Matthew Olivier from the Nashville Predators, but if he does that, Max and Ty would be the first ever father-son combination to each lead the National Hockey League in penalty minutes. Thought that was kind of interesting and a like sidebar story. Ray Ferraro, he and Panger are such great buddies on the golf course, and they've carved this incredible chemistry. They just bring the best out in each other, and I love watching them play golf because Panger becomes more intense and Ray kind of has some fun with it. So they switch their personalities. Ray played with a few different clubs during his time, and one of those was with the Hartford Whalers, and one of his teammates, see there I go pointing again, one of his teammates was Joel Quenneville, who just happens to be the new head coach of our next guest in Sam Bennett. The deadline deal was expected from Sam Bennett's side, but also kind of not, because he'd found a home under Daryl Sutter in Calgary, but he's settling in Florida right now. There's beach, there's hockey, and it's a great mix. He's scoring goals, he's standing up for his teammates, and he's finding life fun as he looks forward to the Stanley Cup playoffs. Here's Sam Bennett on The Chirp with Darren Millard. Can you get back and forth to the hotel, to the practice facility without using the app on your phone to guide you through with the car?
Yeah, I just probably yesterday was the first day I did it without it. So getting used to the roads now.
What's the humidity like?
It's very humid. I haven't stopped sweating since I've been here. So it's warm.
What was it like being traded for the first time?
It was weird. It was a lot of weird emotions. Cause we were all, our whole team in Calgary was all sitting together. We were actually just watching the trade center, and, there was probably about 20 minutes left. And then I got called up to, Tree Living's office. And I mean, as soon as you get called up, you know, something's happening. So, it was definitely a weird feeling, but, I couldn't be happier now, being in Florida for sure.
How do you get called up? Is it a text, or does somebody come over and tap you on the shoulder?
Yeah, our trainer, he came and grabbed me. We were all sitting in the lounge. There was probably like 20 of us sitting in the lounge, and then he just grabbed me and then walked up with him.
I'm curious, is that when all the guys see that, does a hush come over the room, or is there some chirping? I have no idea what happens.
It was quiet. I'm sure after I left the room, everyone was like, oh, he just got traded. But yeah, it was, there was no noise. Everyone was pretty quiet, and I just walked through, and I think it must've came on the TV just as I was going up, because all the guys said they knew before I came back down.
What's the first thing you do? Look at the schedule? Do you look at the roster? How do you approach it?
It was weird this year, because the only hockey that I was paying attention to was the North Division, and I didn't watch any other games. I didn't really know much about Florida. So yeah, the first thing I did was look at the standings and see where they were. And that was the first thing.
Was it a holy crap first place?
Yeah. I was just instantly excited for playoffs. I was like, first place. And looking forward to playoffs instantly.
How far into the process before you go, is somebody wearing 9 there?
No, so I actually didn't look into that at all. The head equipment guy called me and was like, hey, number 93 is retired. What number do you want to be? So the only other number I wore growing up in my life was 9. So that was my first instinct. And then once I found out no one was wearing it, that's what I went with.
What's your first impression of Coach Q?
Oh, he's great. He's been awesome to me. He doesn't really, say too much or try to overcoach me. I think he was really just told me to play my game, and You know, he's been playing me a lot, so I've loved playing for him so far.
Sam, you 19 minutes plus the last two games. It's been a few years since you've done that. What's your body like? Do you feel those extra minutes?
Yeah, I do for sure. I mean, I haven't played this much in a very long time, so definitely a little more tired than I normally am in games, but I'm enjoying every minute of it. So I'll play 30 if he'd let me.
must feel great though, doesn't it, to be tapped on the shoulder and get out there that much?
Yeah, it really does. It's a feeling I haven't had in a long time, where it feels like the team and the coaching staff believe in me and they trust me, and to have that support and that belief, I think that helps me and my confidence, my game. So I'm loving every minute of it.
Is there a bit of vindication in that, in playing those many minutes and having the success that you've had in the short term there?
What do you mean by that?
Like just, I can play this many minutes. I can produce. I can do all this.
Yeah, for sure. I've always known that I want to take on a bigger role and I want to play a bigger role. And, now that I'm getting that opportunity and, I feel like I've been taking advantage of it a little bit. I think, it just proves that I could have been doing this all along. And, I'm happy. I'm not going to get comfortable. I'm not going to get complacent. I know it's only been a couple games, so I still got a lot more to prove and a lot more to give. So I'm just going to keep going out there and playing my game every chance I get.
I can't believe you didn't get the hat trick the other night.
Oh, that was, I had the one, someone sent me a screenshot. Actually, it was, the puck was on the red line against the Dick. So it's fun. I'm having fun. I'm loving playing with Hubie and Dookie. So we're having a blast, and we're getting lots of chances. So I'm really just enjoying it all.
How long does it take you to know a nickname, or do you go with what your own? Like Dookie, is that a standard name, or do you wait to hear somebody else call over to him and then go with Dookie?
I mean, I think a lot of people just call him, Duke too. I think you just hear from other guys. I mean, I'm still, when you first get to a team, you don't really know anyone. It was tough learning names. Like you don't really know the nicknames. So it takes probably about a week to really learn everyone's nickname. And I'm still trying to figure out all the training staff's names too. So it's a lot of names early, but you just listen and go along with it.
What goes farther with the boys, the fight or the goals, the two goal game?
I'm not sure. I think they definitely love the fight. Got a lot of fist bumps, a lot of high fives after that. And that's always a good feeling to, after dropping the gloves, it's a good feeling to get the stick taps from the boys. So I think that one, for me personally, that felt even better from the team.
Where's the snarl come from in your game?
I don't really know. I mean, I've always played like that. I think my dad taught me how to play when I was young, and his favorite player was Doug Gilmore. So I think that's who he tried to make me model my game after. And I've always just had that in my game.
It must be nice playing somebody else right now, different teams.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it's weird because I haven't played any of those teams in so long that I don't even know a bunch of the guys that I'm playing against. So I have to keep asking the guys, like, if there's a new player, I'm like, who's this? Like, what's he all about? So it's definitely refreshing to play some new teams.
You're joining them at a time when they're playing teams for the seventh and eighth times, or you're playing them for the seventh and eighth time. So do you have to find out if there's any history from the first six and who you have to look out for, or if something happens that this is why?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, obviously every new game is different, but you know, just hearing we played Carolina last night and just hearing about you know, the games that Florida's played against them before, and you know, about the players and who to look out for, who's you know, been playing well and all that. So definitely you hear a little bit about it, and you know, the coaches and players have been keeping me up to date.
Are you a beach guy?
I am. I love the beach.
Been over there yet?
Every single off day I've been to the beach. So I went in the ocean a couple of times. It's incredibly warm, and it feels really good for the body. So I've really been enjoying that.
So tarp off, just walk the beach?
Yeah, tarp off, lay in the sand, go in the ocean. I've been loving it. So it's probably 2 years since I've been at the beach. So I've been loving it.
How many selfies or texts back to the boys in Calgary from the beach?
Well, the funny thing is the first day I had an off day, I sent a picture of me on the beach in the ocean. I sent a Snapchat to all the guys, and the guys in Calgary sent one back, and there was about 3 inches of snow. They said some not so nice things back to me. They weren't too happy, but yeah, it's definitely a big change.
When you're traded, like your house or your apartment, I don't know what you have. What do you do? Who takes care of it? If you have plants or pets, or I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty basic guy. I didn't have a lot. I was just in a condo, and I probably had 4 days after the trade where we were trying to get my visa figured out. Mm-hmm. So I actually had time to, I shipped all my stuff back, gave my car back. So, you know, got rid of all that, and it was pretty easy transition.
Did you clean out the fridge? You tell me if you remember that part.
I did. I have a lot in my fridge to begin with. I don't cook a ton, so it was a lot of skip the dishes this year. So that was an easy part.
Did you talk to Daryl before you left? Did you have a chance to have a conversation? Because you guys connected.
Yeah, I did. He actually, one of the first things he said to me was, I wish I had you for longer. So, you know, me and him had a really good relationship. I really liked playing for him, and I believe he liked me as a player. So, yeah, I mean, we didn't really have him for too long, but we definitely had a good relationship. So, you know, he just wished me all the best, and he actually told me he was gonna give Coach Q a call for me. He knows him well, so I'm pretty sure he talked to him about me, and yeah, he made a good, you know, transition for sure.
You ever see a coach like to win as much as Q does? I mean, and like he runs down that hallway after a win and is pumping his fist, and I've never seen anything like it.
Yeah, it's awesome. I mean, he's definitely, he loves the game. He's animated on the bench, and, you know, we hear that. He loves to win, and makes us love to win as well.
The situation in Calgary, was it time? And just on the trade request front, Daren came out with the comments, and your agent, Daren Ferris, do you want to clarify that at all, or where you were in your place in Calgary? Because it seemed to be heading one way, and then when Daryl was hired, it may have settled.
Yeah, I mean, it was, there's no secret, my time in Calgary has not gone the way that, you know, I expected or everyone else probably expected. So, you know, it was a little frustrating this year, you know, just with my opportunity and my role and where it looked like my career was going in Calgary. So, you know, once Dale came in, I felt like a new player again. It was refreshing for sure. And, I was happy there. I was happy playing. So that's kind of how it went. And then obviously you don't really have any control over if you get traded or not. It's completely up to the team. And I'm definitely grateful now that that I got picked up by Florida.
Who's impressed you the most on this squad? You're playing with Huberto and Duclair, which is two uber talented people, and Huberto, we know about his history. Who's jumped out at you?
Well, yeah, definitely those two are unbelievable. And then also Barkov. You know, those guys are guys you don't really, you know, they're really good, but if you don't watch them every day or on the ice with them, you don't really see how talented they are. And some of the plays that these guys make are, they blow my mind. Like, I don't think I've seen someone take the puck off Barkov yet in my, my four games. So he's so strong and so talented. You know, he blows my mind every day.
The shot, and this will sound goofy because he's a 20 goal scorer, but that shot that he scored the other night was like just a rip job. And you shouldn't be surprised because he's a National Hockey Leaguer and a star player, but I was surprised.
Yeah. I mean, he loves to pass it. He's definitely a pass first guy, which is surprising because of how good of a shot he actually does have. So, you know, I wasn't surprised by it because of, you know, what I've seen him do, but yeah, he's a hell of a player.
How about on the back end? Who did you know? Did you know anybody on the team when you joined them?
Not really. I knew Lomberg from Calgary, and the only other player that I knew a little bit was Ekblad. I didn't play World Junior with him because I was injured, but I played under 18s with him. Okay. And he was in my draft class. I mean, I just knew him from growing up in Ontario. So knew him a little bit. And then, yeah, that was pretty much it for the most part.
Friends and family must be happy because you're in the same time zone. They don't have to stay up late.
Yeah, they are. They're very happy. You know, I think they missed a lot of games in Calgary, the late ones, but they haven't missed a game yet here in Florida.
Were you going to, any thought on the mustache? Were you going to get rid of it, keep it? I know it was a thing in Calgary, but carry it over? Where were you?
Yeah. I mean, I'm growing it out right now. I don't really have any plans, but, you know, I might keep it going for playoffs and have it in full form for playoffs.
It's crazy that's become a real thing, right?
Yeah, it is. I mean, fans seem to love it. Everywhere I go, people compliment me on it, and you know, on social media, people are always talking about it, and they love it. So I don't mind it, and I like growing it, so I just might keep it.
Do you have a picture with Lanny? You must have a couple of pictures with Lanny.
Yeah, I think I do.
The two mustaches together.
I'm sure I do somewhere. Yeah.
Did you know there's a Sam Bennett, like a top cyclist, Sam Bennett?
Yeah. People will tweet at me all the time thinking that they're tweeting at the other Sam Bennett. So I get those tweets all the time, and I'm sure the other Sam Bennett gets them as well.
Awesome. Thanks for doing this. Appreciate it. You're such a cool player to watch, and looking forward to this tomorrow. I know you did Calgary, Edmonton for a number of years. I'm looking forward to Tampa and Florida. They've never met in the playoffs, and I think it would be awesome. What do you know about that rivalry?
Yeah, I didn't know too much about it, but my first game was against Tampa, and it was intense. It did kind of feel like the Battle of Alberta. It was that intense, and you know, you just feel it how important it meant to both teams. So it's a great rivalry, and I'm sure it's just going to continue to grow.
Good luck, pal. Happy for you. Really pumped for you, and looking forward to this run.
Thanks a lot, Daren. I appreciate it.
He's rejuvenated. Sam Bennett having fun, and it's interesting when you talk to these athletes, what makes them spark, what eyes light up, going to the beach and just hanging out. And I love the idea of Snapchatting that picture back to his buddies in Calgary. So thanks to the Florida Panthers for setting that up. Also, Nick Foligno, props to Nick Foligno of the Toronto Maple Leafs. Not necessarily for what's happening on the ice, but Nick became our most quoted episode of the Chirp podcast with Daren Millard. Media coming to the Chirp, looking for information and quoting what he said on the Chirp podcast. So if the media is coming to us, like, we're now a source. We are a legitimate source as different outlets look to the Chirp at Daren Millard and taking quotes from our guests. So Nick Foligno was awesome. If you haven't listened to it, check that one out. Just incredible conversation, laid back, very cool. Like John Cooper was in our very first episode. And I bring up John Cooper because they just got their Stanley Cup rings, the Tampa Bay Lightning. And they are beautiful. And so much from the John Cooper conversation is still relevant now as we turn our attention towards the Stanley Cup playoffs. Smash the like button, smash the thumbs up button, subscribe, leave a comment right now. You're sitting there, you're listening to us. Give us a like and let us know what you think. Also, there's a great podcast, Men and Blazers. I'm sure you've heard of it. They have like a hockey angle right now. Roger Bennett sits down with people like Pat Maroon, Sebastian Aho, Ryan Reeves from the Vegas Golden Knights. The popular video series is now a podcast, Men in Blazers on Ice. And I've listened to a couple of episodes and make sure you check that out because it's really cool. So a couple of things for you to do. Smash the like button, smash the thumbs up button. Let us know. So many people listen to this. Get more people liking and then we'll make it available to even more people. As we cruise on the Chirp with Daren Millard. I hope you liked it. Razor was awesome. And so was our good friend, Sam Bennett, who's now a really good friend of mine. Have a good week, everybody. We'll chat with you next week on the Chirp Podcast with Daren Millard.